biologist, and today my lecture is dyslipidemia and clinical correlation. Dyslipidemia, you know, is are disorders of lipoprotein metabolisms, which includes lipoprotein overproductions or deficiencies. These disorders may be manifested by elevations of serum total cholesterol, low density lipoprotein cholesterol and triglycerides concentration, or decrease in the high density lipoproteins. So these are the different types of lipoproteins which are present in the blood: total serum cholesterol, LDL, triglycerides, HDL. What are the good and bad fats? Bad fats, trans fats, which have the risk of atherosclerosis, is high. Artificial trans fats or trans fatty acids are created in an industrial process that adds hydrogen to liquid vegetable oils to make them more solids. Good monounsaturated and polyunsaturated fats, which are including omega-3, because risk of atherosclerosis is very less. So there are good and bad fats. Bad fats are associated with atherosclerosis, and good fats are good for your health. Why we have strong concerns about dyslipidemia? Because there is a very strong relationship between elevated serum cholesterol levels and coronary artery disease. Coronary artery disease means the disease which is related to the coronary arteries of the heart. Coronary artery disease yet remains one of the major killers in current society, and there are variety of other diseases which have close relationship with dyslipidemia. There are mainly two types how we classify dyslipidemia. There are two types of dyslipidemia. One is the primary and other is the secondary. Primary familial hypercholesterolemia, which is also known as primary hypercholesterolemia, dyslipidemia. They are classified in a few classes. Primary hypercholesterolemia, which is the familial hypercholesterolemia, it means that this hypercholesterolemia runs in the families, and this is usually associated with the genesis. So there are different types of familial hypercholesterolemia, which you can see in this chart, that the type 1, which is also known as familial hypercholesterolemia, the defect is in the low LDL, and the clinical features are pancreatitis, lipemia, retinitis, skin eruptions, xanthoma, and hepatosplenomegaly. The treatment for this type of type 1 familial hypercholesterolemia is diet. And when you take out the serum of these patients, you find out that this is creamy top layer. There are type 2A, which is familial hypercholesterolemia, where the defect is in the decreased LDL receptors. So therefore, the clearance of LDL. LDL is the bad cholesterol. Actually, the function of the LDL is to take the cholesterol from the liver to the body organs like muscles and blood vessels. If there is decreased LDL receptors on them, the concentration of the LDL will increase, which can lead to clinical features like xanthelasma, arcus senilis, tendon xanthomas. I will discuss that in the next slide, what are these clinical features. Or if you have attended my last lecture on physical examination, you find out that what are these clinical features. The treatment is statins and niacins. Then there is type 2B, familial combined hypercholesterolemia, and we have type 3, familial dysbeta lipoproteinemia, type 4, familial hyperlipemia. So these are the different types of familial hypercholesterolemias. The most important of them, and these are the secondary causes of hyperlipidemia. So sometimes you find out that there is a familial primary cause of hyperlipidemia, and sometimes the patients may have other medical conditions which can lead to hypercholesterolemia, like hypothyroidism. If the patient has decreased production of the thyroid hormones, they usually you have to check the blood cholesterol levels. Usually you find out that the cholesterol levels will be high. Similarly, the patients with obstructive jaundice, Cushing syndrome is an Cushing syndrome, where there is an increased production of the steroids. Also, you have to check the cholesterol. You do usually find out hypercholesterolemia, anorexia nervosa, nephrotic syndrome, diabetes mellitus, and chronic kidney disease. So all these conditions, it is mandatory to check the cholesterol levels, because these conditions are associated with hypercholesterolemia. Then there are certain drugs. If your patient is on these drugs, you have to check the cholesterol levels. Like if the usually in cardiology, thiazide diuretics we give in patients with heart failure. Glucocorticosteroids or steroids are very common, and they have been given in number of connective tissue diseases. And then beta blockers, which are very common in patients with cardiac diseases. So if the patient are on these medications also, and they are on chronically on these medications for any other illness, very important to check their cholesterol levels, because you can find out a very high cholesterol levels in these patients. Similarly, if the patient is pregnant, then also there is a chance that patient may have hypercholesterolemia. Alcohol abuse is also associated with secondary causes of hyperlipidemia. Very important is that when the patient came to you in the clinic or in the OPD, what are the features which give or which raise the suspicion that patient have hypercholesterolemia or they have familial hypercholesterolemia? What are the signs? Number one is the premature arcus senilis. There is actually around the cornea, there is a white or gray opaque ring which is present around the cornea of the eyes. So that is known as premature arcus senilis. Other is the tendon xanthomas. They are the hard, non-tender, nodular enlargement of the tendons. You know the tendons? There is Achilles tendons in the foot, and there are knuckles. So if you find out that there are a hard, non-tender, nodular enlargements, these are known as tendon xanthomas. And finally, xanthelismas. If you find out that there are fatty streaks present on the eyelids, they are known as xanthelismas. Okay. So if you find patients have all these features, and they are also giving you the history of a premature coronary artery disease, what you have to do is you have to do a lipid profile. Whenever you find out these symptoms or signs, you will send the patient for the fasting lipid panels. And what are the important lipid profile includes? Whenever you get the lipid profile of any patients, what things you have to see in that lipid profile? Number one is the low density lipoproteins, that is the LDL, then the high density lipoprotein HDL. What is the difference between the low density lipoprotein is that it takes the cholesterol which is formed in the liver to the body. For example, it will take it to the coronary arteries, it will take it to the brain arteries, it will take to the muscles. Whereas the high density lipoprotein is a good cholesterol, because the function of the high density lipoprotein is to bring the cholesterol from the body to the liver for excretion. So it will decrease the bad cholesterol levels in the body. Triglycerides, total cholesterols, these are also very important. whenever you are going to check the lipid profile, it is mandatory to check the total cholesterol, triglycerides, low density lipoproteins and high density lipoproteins. So what is the importance of the total cholesterol level in a patient, or how you check that this patient has hypercholesterolemia or not? So when you go and check a lipid panel of any patient and you find out that the total cholesterol level is less than 200 milligram per deciliter, it is normal. If you check a lipid panel of any patient and the total cholesterol level is less than 200 milligram per deciliter, this is a normal cholesterol level. If the total cholesterol level of that patient is between 200 to 239 milligram per deciliter, it is borderline high. And if the total cholesterol level is greater than or equal to 240 milligram per deciliter, it means definitely this patient has high cholesterol level. What about the triglycerides levels? Because these are also very important. Whenever you get the lipid panel, you will find out that there are triglyceride levels. So what is the normal value and how you diagnose the patient? So if the patient has the triglyceride levels of less than 150 milligram per deciliter, this is normal triglyceride levels. So high triglyceride levels are also associated with increased risk of cardiovascular disease. If it is less than 150 milligram per deciliter, it is normal. If it is between 150 to 199 milligram per deciliter, the triglyceride levels are borderline high. If it is between 200 to 500, this is high. And if the triglyceride levels are greater than 500 milligram per deciliter, it means the triglyceride levels are very high. So very important to check the triglyceride levels in the lipid panel. Then the high density lipoprotein levels, a level which is greater than or equal to 60 milligram per deciliter is excellent levels, because if the patient has the high density lipoprotein levels of greater than or equal to 60, this is protective. So if the patient, male or female, have a HDL level of greater than 60 milligram per deciliter, it is protective. While the levels of HDL cholesterol, if they are less than 40 milligram per deciliter, then this is a risk factor for coronary artery disease or other diseases. Now we will come to again to familial hypercholesterolemia, which we discussed previously. When you suspect familial hypercholesterolemia, a patient came to you if you are doing a cardiology rotation, or you will go to the cardiology outpatient department, and the male or female came to you in an outpatient department and he show you that he has raised total cholesterol concentration. Raised total cholesterol concentration is found out in that lipid panel, and it is more than 290 milligram per deciliter. The cholesterol level is around 300. And secondly, there is also a personal or family history of premature coronary artery disease. How you define the family history of premature coronary artery disease? That the male, in the male less than 55 years, and in the females less than 65 years. This patient has a history of myocardial infarction, that means heart attacks. If the family patient has the history of coronary artery bypass grafting or PCI, so then this is the positive, or there is a history of sudden cardiac death. In males, less than 55 years is the cutoff, and in females, less than 65 years. So if the patient has this cutoff value, then you will say that you suspect familial hypercholesterolemia. Patient have total cholesterol more than 290, and there is a personal or family history of coronary artery disease. You have to rule out the secondary causes of hypercholesterolemia, which we have discussed previously, which includes the medical conditions as well as the medications. मेक अ डायग्नोसिस देर इज वन क्राइटेरिया नोन एज साइमन ब्रूम क्राइटेरिया देन यू हैव टू चेक एटलीस्ट टू फास्टिंग एलडीएल मेजरमेंट टू कंफर्म द डायग्नोसिस. What is the Simon Broom diagnostic criteria for familial hypercholesterolemia? Definite familial hypercholesterolemia is diagnosed if an individual has a total cholesterol levels which I have told you previously, you suspect a patient came to you in an outpatient department showing the lipid panel that the total cholesterol level is more than 290 milligram per deciliter and the LDL level. Second thing you have to see is the low density lipoprotein. If the low density lipoprotein levels are more than 190 and the total cholesterol is more than 290, plus patients have tendon xanthomas, which I have already told you that there are hard nodules present on the tendons, most likely on the Achilles tendons, on the knuckles, or there are signs in the first degree or second degree relatives of premature coronary artery disease, then this is a definite familial hypercholesterolemia. Familial hypercholesterolemia, why it is important? Because this familial hypercholesterolemia is associated with premature coronary artery disease and deaths. Usually young male or young female came to you with a myocardial infarction, heart attack, or any other disease. And this is very important to rule out because they will give sudden cardiac death at a very young age. So possible familial hypercholesterolemia should be diagnosed if the individual has at least one of the following: family history of myocardial infarction, family history of raised triglyceride levels. So you have to see what is the most common genetic. I have already told you previously in the chart which shows the grading of the familial hypercholesterolemia, what is the most common type of this familial hypercholesterolemia is the familial combined hyperlipidemia. If the patient came to you, you have to see that there is this is the most common genetic dyslipidemia. And this occurs in about 1 in 100 people. Usually what you find in familial combined hyperlipidemia that there is typically a combined type of cholesterolemia. That is, the total cholesterol is also increased. It is between 250 to 310. And the triglyceride levels are also increased. They are between 200 to 440. So this is the familial combined hyperlipidemia. This is the short description about lipoprotein levels. Number one is the very low density lipoproteins. Very low density lipoproteins are actually the precursors of the LDL, which is the bad cholesterol. So very low density lipoproteins are the precursor of low density lipoproteins in the liver. Because in the liver, the most of the production of the cholesterol occurs in the liver. So, and the main protein which is responsible for the production of that cholesterol and take it to the different parts of the body is very low density lipoprotein, which is converted to low density lipoprotein. Very low density lipoprotein, they constitutes about 10 to 15% of the total cholesterol. Then low density lipoproteins, which are formed from very, very low density lipoprotein, they make up 60 to 70% of the total cholesterol. And they are the main form of the bad cholesterol, cause buildup of the plaque inside the arteries. And third is the high density lipoproteins. They make up 20 to 30% of the total cholesterol. This is the good cholesterol, and they move the cholesterol from the arteries to the liver for excretion. Then what is the clinical importance of this high cholesterol? When the patient came to you and show you the lipid panel, which shows a very high cholesterol levels are more than 240, LDL level is more than 160, HDL is low. What is the clinical importance is that there is the formation of plaque. plaque which is formed inside the arteries. Most common arteries which give rise to plaque are the coronary arteries, the peripheral arteries, cerebral arteries. These are the arteries in which the plaque is built up inside the arteries. What is a plaque? Plaque is actually made up of cholesterol, calcium, fibrin. I will show you here what is the pathology. You know, and you must know that every coronary arteries or any artery, there is a layer of endothelium inside the arteries, and that if that endothelium is damaged, for example from the smoking, hypertension, elevated blood cholesterol, then that if the endothelium is damaged, and inside there is a fatty streak formation in the vessel wall. There is if the cholesterol level is high, from that endothelial damage, that cholesterol starts to deposits inside the vessel wall, and timely, gradually that fats accumulate in the vessel wall, and there are also active WBCs and other inflammatory cells schemes. Finally, they results in reduction in the arterial wall diameter and elasticity. So this is the figure which you can see here, that initial lesion normal, then fatty streaks which are mainly intracellular. Fatty streak means the fat is inside the cell, not came extracellular. Okay, when you called it atheroma, intracellular lipid accumulation is there, but along with that there is an extracellular lipid. So much the cholesterol is increasing so much that they are not only present inside the cells of the vessels, but they came extracellular also. And finally, in fibroatheroma you will find out single or multiple lipid cores. These are the complicated lesions. So very important, when you came to the clinical rotation in cardiology, the most important thing which is related to very high cholesterol level is the plaques. Plaques, and you will came to know that there are two types of plaques which are very important. One is the stable plaques, which are less symptomatic or asymptomatic, and the other is the unstable plaque, where there is a high risk of rupture and causing the ischemic event. You can see in this figure what is the difference between the stable plaque and unstable plaque. In a stable plaque, if you came to know that in the stable plaque, this is the coronary vessels lumen, this is the lumen, and this is the endothelium, this one, and here in the yellow they show you lipid core. This is very small yellow color you can see here, and this is the fibrous cap. This is the fibrous cap which is very thick, and you can see that there are very few WBCs, very few, there is no hemorrhage inside. But in the other one you can see that the lipid, the yellow color is increased. So the with high cholesterol lipid core increase, there is a cap become very thin, there are more WBCs, and there is hemorrhage, cap ruptured. When there is a cap is ruptured, what happened is that there are platelets, intracoagulation, platelets start to plug in, the coagulation factors start to plug in, which finally related to a formation of a thrombus. When there is a thrombus formation, the lumen of the vessels become occluded. If it is completely occluded, it give rise to ST elevation MI. If it is partially occluded, it gives rise to non-ST elevation MI or unstable angina in cardiology. But if these things are happening in the cerebral arteries, it can give rise to stroke. If it occurs in peripheral arteries, it can give rise to peripheral arterial disease. So very important, this is the clinical importance of the high cholesterol level. So if the persistently you have high cholesterol levels, these are the risk factors for atherosclerosis. So I already told you what are the risks: increasing age, gender. Males are more prone to develop atherosclerosis, that is the accumulation of lipids, and coronary artery disease. If there is a family history, hyperlipidemia, hypertension, cigarette smoking, diabetes. So every patient which came to you, you have to take a comprehensive history of the risk factors of atherosclerosis. Less certain risk factors are obesity, physical inactivity, stress, and high carbohydrate intakes. So disease which are associated with atherosclerosis, most common disease, which I already told you, is the ischemic heart disease. But if that lipid accumulation occurs in the carotid artery, it can give rise to carotid artery disease and stroke. If it occurs in the peripheral arteries, it can give rise to peripheral vascular disease. Chronic kidney disease can also occur. So there are what you have to advise the patient. Whenever you find out that the patient has a hypercholesterolemia, but he had no event, what you have to advise? Lifestyle. Diet. Diet is very important, means low calorie diet. You have to take more fruits, more vegetables, less junk food, more exercise, at least 30 minutes a day for whole week, or 150 minutes per week. And you have to control the diabetes. You have to well know about the side effects of the therapy. And this is important. If the risk of the patient is very low, for example, if the patient is asymptomatic, he has no heart attack, no stroke, no peripheral artery disease, and the LDL level, you will check the LDL level in the lipid panel, it is less than 190, the risk of the patient is low. No need of any medical therapy, just diet and exercise. But if the risk is very high, for example, the patient has a heart attack in the past, the person may benefit from statins. This is very important new guidelines from the American College of Cardiology. Number one, people who already have cardiovascular diseases, for example, they had heart attack, strokes, or mini strokes, transient ischemic attack, peripheral artery disease. So they all these groups needs statin therapy, HMG-CoA reductase inhibitor to decrease their cholesterol. Patients who don't have these diseases but have very high LDL cholesterol, for example, the LDL cholesterol of 190 milligram per deciliter or higher. The third group is the patients who have diabetes. This group includes adults who have diabetes and an LDL between 70 and 189. And the fourth group is patients who have the higher 10-year risk of heart attack. This group includes patients who have LDL above 100 and whose 10-year risk of heart attack is 7.5% or higher. That 10-year risk is calculated from the Framingham score. Hypertriglyceridemia, you have to control triglyceride levels, because if you control triglyceride levels, it also prevents pancreatitis. Treatment options are fibrates, niacins, omega-3 fatty acids. Statins may be used as combination therapy. If you have high LDL, statins are the most important drugs because they reduce the synthesis of cholesterol in the liver by competitively inhibiting HMG-CoA reductase activity. Commonly used statins are atorvastatins, fluvastatins, lovastatins, pravastatins, rosuvastatins, simvastatins. And usually, very important things to know about the statins, there are two serious side effects: myopathy, which may progress to rhabdomyolysis, and the second is the hepatocellular damage. So whenever you start the patient on statins, the important thing is that know that they don't have any muscle damage. Second, you have to calculate their LFTs. If the LFTs are done and they are more than three-folds from the normal, you have to stop the statins. Otherwise, you can continue. These other drugs are that which decrease the absorption of cholesterol from the intestine. This is ezetimibe. Is the first lipid-lowering drug that inhibits intestinal uptake of dietary and biliary cholesterol. Low HDL is only managed with exercise, and usually there are usually no medications can increase the HDL levels. And sometimes you have to use the nicotinic acid, appears to increase HDL by partially reducing cholesterol catabolism. थैंक यू वेरी मच। सही है ना, अभी टाइम पे खत्म हो गया ना। हाँ टाइम पे खत्म हुआ है, कुछ पूछा तो है। नहीं चैट में जाएंगे तो आएगा ना कुछ। चल एनी क्वेश्चन। यू आर आस्किंग अबाउट मॉडरेट एल्कोहल यूज विच कैन इंक्रीज द एचडीएल। इट माइट इंक्रीज द एचडीएल लो और मॉडरेट यूज ऑफ एल्कोहल, बट द प्रॉब्लम विद द एल्कोहल इज दैट दैट यू कैन नॉट कंट्रोल द कंजम्पशन ऑफ द एल्कोहल एंड ऑल्सो इट मे इट देर आर मैनी थिंग्स विच कैन बी एसोसिएटेड एंड यू कैन नॉट हैव control on use of cholesterol that you can use low or moderate. Can you show the drug slides again? पीछे जाना पड़ेगा।
कहाँ पे?
पीछे पीछे।
इससे जाए, इससे जाए, सर इससे जाए।
You are asking about the statins or you which can which are used for treating the hypercholesterolemia? One is these are the important drugs, the statins which are metabolized in the liver, and most common statins which we are using are the atorvastatin, which you come to the our ward, you find out that these are the most commonly used. Atorvastatins, rosuvastatins, other fluvastatins, lovastatins, pravastatins, simvastatins, they can be used, but usually in Pakistan, atorvastatin and rosuvastatins are the statins which have the largest trial to decrease the cardiovascular risk. And they are mainly, what is the mechanism? They reduce synthesis of cholesterol in the liver by competitively inhibiting HMG-CoA reductase inhibitors. And regarding their side effects, they are, number one is the myopathy, second is the hepatocellular damage. Aur bhi kuch pooch raha hai mera khayal hai.
Sorry. Sir, second class bhi karani hai. Mera khayal khatam ho gaya. Ab nahi hai. Nahi koi kar raha
hai. Nahi kar raha hai.
Nahi.
Bas theek. खत्म कर दें,
एंड कर दूं सर।
हाँ सही है ना।
देखिए सर कोई क्वेश्चन नहीं है। थैंक यू सर, आ गया, एंड करूं सर। थैंक यू सर।